Namaste, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning and welcome to Canada India Foundation's 21st session of our virtual webinar speaker series on Ayurveda. My name is Satish Thakkar, Chair of Canada India Foundation, and we have our national convener, Mr. Ritesh Palik, and Dr. Harish Verma, President, Canadian Ayurvedic Practitioner Association, with us. Friends, we also have Honorable Deepak Anand, Member of Provincial Parliament and Parliamentary Secretary to Ministry of Training and Skill Development, with us as a special guest. A very warm welcome to Mr. Anand for our session. And our expert speaker of today is Dr. Milind Patel. He will appraise us on Ayurvedic management of dementia. Welcome, Dr. Patel. Friends, dementia is a syndrome usually of a chronic or progressive nature in which there is a deterioration in the cognitive function beyond what might be expected from normal aging. It affects memory, thinking, orientation, comprehension, calculation, learning capacity, language, and judgment. It is one of the major causes of disability and dependency among older people worldwide. As per data of World Health Organization, worldwide around 50 million people have dementia, with nearly 60% living in low and middle income countries. Total number of people with dementia is projected to reach 82 million in 2030 and 152 million in 2050. WHO also declared it as a public health priority and issued a blueprint for action for policymakers, international, regional, and national partners. In Canada, over 500,000 Canadians are living with dementia. It is estimated that by the year 2030, the number will go up to 912,000. Nearly 76,000 Canadians diagnosed with dementia every year. 65% of those diagnosed with dementia over the age of 65 are women. Over $12 billion is the annual cost to Canadians to care for those living with dementia. Dementia has significant social economic implication in terms of direct medical and social care cost. And in 2015, the total global societal cost of dementia was estimated to be US$818 billion. Friends, the objective of today's webinar is to understand how our 6,000-year-old Ayurveda as an effective alternative healthcare system can provide remedy, preventative measures for dementia. Friends, this Ayurvedic lecture series is in partnership with Canadian Ayurvedic Practitioner Association, Council General of India in Toronto, and Vedic Spiritual Heritage Foundation. Before we begin, let me invite our national convener, Mr. Ritesh Malik, to introduce our special guest, Mr. Deepak Anand. Ritesh, over to you.
Thank you, Satish ji. Namaste and welcome, everyone. Our special guest today, Deepak Anand, is the Member of Provincial Parliament for Mississauga Malton, Member Standing Committee on Public Accounts, Chair Standing Committee on Social Policy, and recently got the important appointment as Parliamentary Assistant to the Minister of Labour, Training and Skills Development. His priorities as an MPP are youth empowerment, local employment, public housing, and community engagement, with an aim to be active, inspired, and motivated to bring about positive change to the area. He has always participated in volunteering programs and various community initiatives. MPP Anand is an undergraduate in chemical engineering and has studied MBA at the Schulich School of Business. He has put his entrepreneurial skills to good use for residents of his riding and Ontario as large, as he is the founder of Meaningful Media, an organization that brings light to different charities. He was also the producer and host for Radio Sanj, a radio show that discussed local issues and provided exposure to different local organizations working for the betterment of the community. As we fondly call him, Deepak Bhai, over to you.
Thank you so much, Ritesh bhai, and namaste to all of you. It sounds so sweet when one brother is praising the other brother, and then the first brother has to go back and praise the same, because you know, the amount of work, Ritesh, you are doing in the community is incredible. We know about the issue we had in the past, and you were fighter, fighting day and night, tooth and nail, with the Ministry of Education, and I commend you for everything that you do for our community. So thank you so much. And again, welcome, Dr. Patil. You know, we just had a quick chat offline before the event started, and I can tell you, within that fraction of second, I could feel and sense that, you know, we're going to hear a wonderful information from you. So we cannot thank you enough for taking time, especially at this late hours in India. So really appreciate it. Again, Dr. Verma, every time I see you, I hear you. Dr. Patil, what you're doing today, Dr. Verma, day it for our community here in Canada every day. So thank you so much. CIF, you know, I do remember when Satishji started this series, and I was one of the first ones to be part of this, you know, on Ayurveda. And I do remember we talked on COVID-19. But what is commendable is that, you know, you continued it. That sustainability that, you know, not just came, dropped a piece and left, but you continued this conversation. So thank you, CIF, for your continued support. As I would like to congratulate you, you're not only saying it, but you're actually doing it. That is why you are able to start with $1 million. Dekhe, kehna ek baat hota hai, par karne ke liye you need money, but you were not just talking, you were doing things. So I would like to congratulate whole CIF for collaborating with UHN, which is one of the world's best health network, and Canada's, of course, number one health network, for doing starting a $1 million research collaboration fund, so that we can have an integrated medicine, which is the medicine of our future. So uske liye bahut bahut dhanyawad. Satish ji, you talked very well about dementia. A lot of us don't know about the dementia well. It is the gradual loss of cognitive functioning, ranging from thinking, remembering, ultimately loss of reasoning. You talked about the number in the world, and then you moved up to the Canada. So I want to further subdivide those numbers. I want to tell you that in our Ontario, you said there are about 500,000 Canadians in with dementia. Out of those 500,000, 240,000 actually live in Ontario. And within my riding of Mississauga Malton, हमारे एक long-term care center है, जिसमें we call it a butterfly village. Butterfly village is a concept for dementia patients, which is the world's one of its own kind. And उसमें क्या करते हैं कि when somebody is with the dementia, rather than having them housing as if it is a jail, they convert their house or their room going into the past memories. So unse bachchon se, unke family members se, aaj se 20 ya 25 saal purani picture jis ghar mein wo rehte the, wo leke us ghar ko aise sajate hain jaise that house is that what they had in 25 years back, so that they feel at home. And that has shown a good result. This is one of the ways your government of Ontario is working with you. We recently announced in February 2021 investment of $23.5 million over next 5 years for the Center of Aging and Brain Health Innovation, to improve the quality of life for seniors with dementia and Alzheimer's. The funding will support innovative research and programs to help seniors and brain health related issues, living at home longer and reduce the cost of care delivery. Along with that, as you know, in April 2021, Ontario also introduced legislation that will create a new framework for the regulation of personal safety workers. For 2022, the Ministry of Health is going to be investing $111 million for high intensity home support program. And the reason I'm talking about the money cannot bring everything, but money can help to bring that delivery of the service. And not just this, the Ministry of Long-Term Care is also allocating $20 million for the paramedic program to provide services to the seniors. And I would say to CIF, when it comes to the South Asian, one of the biggest challenges we've seen, whether it is with autism, whether it is with dementia, whether it is with Alzheimer's, it is the stigma. You know, we as South Asians hesitant to talk about it. Ki hamare ghar mein kisi ko hua hai, kisi ko problem hai. So we want help and support at that point. जब हमें पता है कि कोई प्रॉब्लम है, अगर हम उसको डिनाई करेंगे, डिनाई करने से वो प्रॉब्लम दूर नहीं हो जाती है. इट्स समथिंग लाइक वी हैव सीन इट, यू नो, जैसे कबूतर बिल्ली को देख के आंख बंद कर देते तो बिल्ली नहीं चली जाती है, रादर उसके इफेक्ट होते हैं. सो व्हाट वी नीड टू डू इज वी नीड योर सपोर्ट इन डाइल्यूटिंग दैट स्टिग्मा, एंड आई डोंट थिंक एनीवन अदर देन योर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन कैन कंट्रीब्यूट. सो विद दोस नोट्स, डॉक्टर साहब, I'm looking forward. I will be turning off the camera. I might disconnect because of the connection. But thanks to CIF and thanks to technology, I will be listening each and every second subsequently. Dhanyawad.
Thank you so very much, Deepakji, for your time and your leadership. I know you've been traveling and sparing some of your valuable time for this cause speaks of your passion and commitment. Thank you so very much for
सतीश जी, उसमें दो या तीन चीजें जरूर ऐड करूंगा मैं. पहला कि जब आप कभी भी इनविटेशन देते हो तो हमेशा मेरा आंसर यस होता है. आई न्यू आई विल बी ट्रैवलिंग बट आई थॉट आई कैन नॉट से नो, बट इफ यू हैव टू से थैंक यू, यू शुड से थैंक यू टू अभय वैद जी हु इज एक्चुअली ड्राइविंग एंड सपोर्टिंग मी. सो थैंक यू अभय जी एज वेल.
थैंक यू सो वेरी मच. फ्रेंड्स, नाउ लेट मी invite our speaker of this morning, Dr. Milind Patil. He has done his MD in Ayurveda, Sahita and Siddhant. He has a very long teaching experience at R.A. Podar Ayurveda Medical College and Hospital and headed the Department of Ayurveda Sahita and Siddhant at YMT Ayurvedic Medical College in Kharghar. He's well known for his four-hour module of Panchdashi, the art of learning Charak Sahita by heart. He has delivered this course over 100 times. On the clinical trial front, his experience and expertise cover the entire gamut of therapeutic specialty, where he has scientifically studied herbal actives as well as finished formulations. Since 1996, he's a well-known pharmaceutical physician, having experience of pharmaceutical giants like Charak, Raptacos, Copran, and Themis, etc. And currently, he's the medical advisor at Sandu Pharmaceutical Limited in Mumbai, India. Thank you once again, Dr. Patil, for joining, and we are looking forward to your exciting presentation. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Shall I begin?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I'll share the screen first. Yeah, I hope that screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So thank you to all of you, my dear friends. And you have really reduced my burden because you did talk about the numbers of dementia patients, et cetera, et cetera. So I will not go into those details of prevalence and incidence of dementia, the world over, and particularly in your region. But then I will make sure that we all understand what Ayurveda is like and what Ayurveda can do, what Ayurveda can contribute to relieve this condition, to give relief to patients who suffer from dementia. So before I begin, I think it is right to understand what Ayurveda is, because unless and understand we understand the basic principles of Ayurveda, we won't be able to understand what those medicines will do in dementia patients. So let us begin. Before I forget, I am 63 years old. So before I forget my content of the presentations, I think let us begin at the beginning. And how do we begin the beginnings? We remember our gurus. We do Mangala Charan. This is my Guruji, Vedya Vasudevji Vyas. He was a very famous teacher. Just understand the title of the slide, the genius par excellence. Okay, so to remember Vyasji at the beginning is the right start of dementia lecture, because he was very bright. His memory was very sharp. He was witty enough and he knew his shastras inside out. He always told us, it was my admission in 1977 in BMS college. First teacher that I faced in college was Dr. Vaidya Vasudev Vyas, and he told us, Ayurvedopadesheshu. Hello? Hello?
Sir, your slides are not moving.
Why? Now?
No, just...
This, you see?
Yeah, it has to be done at your end.
Yeah, I'm doing it. Do you see the slide of Vaidya Vasudev Vyas?
No.
I'm moving those slides.
Just make it to the presentation mode.
I think this is on the presentation mode. If I...
Hello?
Now does it move?
No.
Because no, I can see the slide not moving. No.
Just double click on the photo.
Now,
Pavan,
I think there's some problem at your end, because
you may reshare. Pavan, you have the presentation.
Yeah.
Can you do it from the background?
Okay. Okay, I will pause share and share it again. I think, is it okay now? Can you see the slides moving?
We can see the slide, but not moving.
Now, see, this is the first slide. Now,
only first slide is visible.
Okay. Stop share. I stop sharing. Then, Nikhil. That I did, yeah. No, I'm sharing slides again. Okay, does it move now?
Yes, now it's moving.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Yes,
sorry for that. Yeah,
okay, I'm really extremely sorry. This was my colleague guiding me from a distance. Okay, so I will go back to my first slide. Let us understand what Ayurveda is like. And it was 1977 when I took admission to first year BMS. And Vaidya Vasudevji Vyas was my teacher. And as the title of the slide says, the genius par excellence. He was the most intelligent, the bestest of the best memory. And he was very witty too. But then he always asked us, his students, to respect Ayurveda. And he said that Ayurvedopadesheshu Videha Paramadara. You should express extreme respect. You should have extreme respect towards the guidance of Ayurveda. And the respect is described as, you should do the reading, you should understand the science, and you should practice the medicine. And that is the way of giving respect to Ayurveda. He always told us that even if you don't understand the principles of Ayurveda today, maybe in future, as the modern sciences develop, they will understand what the Ayurvedic principles are, and then you will start having utmost faith in Ayurveda. But then 1977, for youngsters like us, it was a bit difficult to have a faith in Shastra, which was written in Sanskrit. The textbooks were in Sanskrit, and so it was really difficult. But then we could understand the sincerity and the passion of Vedavyas in teaching Ayurveda, and that helped us have a faith, utmost faith in Ayurveda, and just try to understand what happens next. In first year, he did teach me Brahme Muhurte Uttishte Swasto Raksharatham Ayushaha. The Sanskrit is quite simple, my friends. I will read differently. Ayushaha Raksharatham, to protect your life, to increase the longevity, the length of life. Swastha Vyakti, the healthy person, should get up early in the morning. And what is that early in the morning defined as? That is called as Brahma Muhurta. Just try to understand the meaning of Brahma. Brahma is denoting Gyan, Nyan, knowledge and cognition. And we used to wonder what exactly does this mean. So Brahma Muhurta is almost 1.5 hour before Suryodaya, that is sunrise. And if you get up early in the morning at that time and start your day, you are allowing this internal clock, which is controlled by the brain. And this internal clock, which is controlled by the brain, manages all other systems like respiratory, circulatory, digestive, excretory systems. So all other systems in the body depend on or sensitized to or synchronized by a biological clock. And this biological clock moves according to Brahme Muhurte. So if you set your sleep-wake cycle this way, you remain healthy and you live a very healthy, long life. That is the meaning of Ayushaha Raksharatham Swastaha Purushaha Brahme Muhurte Uttishte. For long life, the healthy person should get up early in the morning so that the systems, the biology, the whole organism works according to some biological clock which begins at Brahma Muhurta, because evolution has made us, the organism, behave according to day and night cycle. And that's how the first shloka that we learned in our Ayurvedic course was Brahma Muhurte Uttishte Swasto Raksharatham Ayusha. And just see this slide published in 2020 or 2018 journal. It says circadian rhythms, pathways and cognitive impairment. And then you understand, these are all Latin and Greek words for Ayurvedic person. But when I tell you that autophagy is the mechanism identified as the mode of action of langan, upvas. And langan is the major treatment as described by Ayurveda. Then if I tell you the long form, mammalian target of or mechanistic target of rapamycin, we may not understand the meaning of it. But if I tell you that mammalian target of rapamycin is the regulator of the metabolism, we understand this mTOR as Agni controller. So the moment the organism ingests some food, mammalian target of rapamycin knows it and it manages the nutrient, the nutrition, the protein, carbohydrate mobilization. And this SIRT1 is a bio principle which has anti-aging properties. And if these are controlled by circadian rhythms, and we keep that biological clock playing rightly in a correct fashion, just by getting up early in the morning, then you have your biological clock rhythm balanced. Then you can promote your cellular survival and mitochondrial function, and you can limit age-related disorders. You can limit the inflammation. You can limit the oxidative stress. So just by getting up early in the morning at the Brahma Muhurta, make sure that the 24 hours you have equilibrium in your body, equilibrium in your functional elements like Vata, Pitta, Kapha, equilibrium in your structural elements like Rasa, Rakta, Mans, Med, Asthi, Majja, Shukra, etc., etc. Cellular survival is promoted. You remain healthy. Mitochondrial function is normalized. Your Agni is proper and you limit your age-related disorders. Aging is slowed down. Inflammation is less and oxidative stress is less. So you age not at all if you follow this one principle. So basic principle of Ayurveda is you need to be living in a natural fashion. Friends, it all began with, just look at the figure, homeostasis. Just look at that balance. Okay, Hanumanji is balanced and he is balancing Sanjeevani. He is balancing that parvat on his palm of the hand. This balance is very important in Ayurveda. Okay, balanced Vata, Pitta, Kapha will make sure that Rasa, Rakta, Mans, Med, Asthi, Majja, Shukra, these structural elements remain in good condition. And therefore, we need to understand this balance concept in quite detail. See this? Balance is the key to life. So, whole day, we have to follow a certain daily routines. Whole year, we have to follow certain seasonal routines, which are called as Dinacharya and Rutucharya in Ayurveda. And the objective of following Dinacharya, the objective of following Rutucharya is nothing but to keep the balance intact. So that all the structure and function is balanced in equilibrium and in a homeostatic mode. Just understand the title of the book, Lifestyle Medicine, written by edited by a cardiologist. This cardiologist is pioneer in promoting lifestyle medicine. When I read this book, I realized that the title of the book means nothing but Ayurveda. So looking at the cover, I felt that, yeah, this is lifestyle medicine. This must have some relevance to our Ayurvedic books, Ayurvedic Shastra, Ayurvedic science. Then I opened the book and what do I find in the book? I find chapters and chapters and chapters which talk about Ayurvedic principles in modern scientific language. It does talk about the importance of regular physical activity. It does talk about proper nutrition. It does talk about weight management. And it does talk about principles which help us treat disease conditions right from heart disease, diabetes, cancer, mental stress, addiction, and injury prevention. And that time I realized this book is published in 2013. I must have seen that book first time in 2015 or so. This time, the moment I saw this book, I realized that Ayurveda is becoming a modern science, or modern science is becoming Ayurvedic science. Okay, and therefore the relevance of Ayurveda in control of dementia is very important. Just see this: regular physical activity, proper nutrition, importance of these two factors in keeping you healthy and making your life long and healthy, fruitful. Regular physical activity and proper nutrition. Why I'm making you understand this again and again? Because I want to attract your attention to the next slide. The shloka, parishrama mitaharau, bhugatau ashwini sutau, tau anadrutya naivaham, vaidyam annam shamashray, comes from 2,000-year-old book or 3,000-year-old book, Harita Samhita. Some of the reference, some of the literature give Taittiriya Upanishad as the book reference of the shloka. The meaning of the shloka is something like this. A diseased person is very envious of his healthy friend. And he asks his healthy friend, how come you are so healthy? Which physician do you go to? Whose treatment do you seek for remaining such a healthy state? And then this healthy person tells him that my friend, parishram, that is diet control, physical exercise, and mitahar, that is diet control, are the two Ashwini Kumars available for us on the earth. Ashwini Kumars are twin deities. They are physician and surgeon, and they offer treatment to the gods. But then who does represent Ashwini Kumars on earth? He says, Bhugatau, on earth, Ashwini Kumars are Parishram, that is exercise, and Mitahar, that is diet control. And then Tau Anadrukta Naivaham Vedyam Annam Shamashre. And I don't disrespect them. And because I don't disrespect them, I follow them in my daily practice. I don't have to go to any other Vedya. That's how that healthy person is recommending Parishram and Mitahar, diet control and exercise, to his ill friend. Okay. Parishram, as I explained in my classes, Parishram is a surgeon, because when I put up that board, Dr. Milind Patil, physician and surgeon, Parishram is a surgeon. Daily walk, daily exercise is daily angioplasty, my friends, daily surgery. It cleanses your blood vessels. It cleanses your arteries. It makes your endothelium, the innermost lining of the arteries, healthy. And what is Mitahar? Mitahar or diet control keeps your blood sugar, keeps your cholesterol normal. Okay, so these are the physicians and surgeons, Mitahar and Parishram. So when it comes to management of dementia, I think exercise and diet control do play a very, very important role. And that's how I think we should start prevention of dementia by following Mitahar and Parishram. Just try to understand, this is 2 to 3,000 year old shloka. Some literature talks about this shloka as coming from Taittiriya Upanishad, the oldest Sanskrit literature that is available to us. And in a very crystal clear fashion, in a very clear way, they talk about the medicinal, the therapeutic effect of Parishram, physical activity, and Mitahar, calorie restriction. Then when these terms are translated into modern medicine, how do they translate? Parishram becomes physical activity, physical exercise, and Mitahar becomes calorie restriction. Okay, and that's how today's modern textbooks do talk about the importance of physical activity and calorie restriction. Just see this. The Exercise is Medicine, Global Health Initiative, published in 2014. What does it say? That broad implementation of physical activity, counseling, and referral systems as clinical practice standard of care has a potential to improve physical activity at the population level by complementing and leveraging other efforts, and to contribute to achieving global targets for the reduction of inactivity and related morbidity and mortality. I will draw your attention to this last word, reduction of inactivity, that is having Parishram every day, and reduction of related morbidity and mortality. This is published in 2014. The title reads as The Exercise is Medicine, and you don't really find a difference of opinion in this shloka. Parishram Mitaharo are Ashwini Kumars available to us on the earth. And who are those Parishram and Mitahar? Parishram is exercise, is a surgeon, Delhi angioplasty. And Mitahar is a physician, and he makes sure that your blood sugar and cholesterol and overall your health is normal. So Shloka, which is 3,000 year old, the article appearing in British Journal of Sport Medicine, talking of exercise as a medicine, is really wonderful for Ayurvedic people to understand. Just read this, calorie restriction as a new treatment of inflammatory disease. So the balance between energy consumption and energy expenditure, do you see Mitahar here? Do you appreciate Parishram here? Just read that line. The balance between energy consumption and energy expenditure is critical for longevity. So excessive energy intake and adiposity cause systemic inflammation, whereas Mitahar, calorie restriction, exerts a potent anti-inflammatory effect. I think with this, I'll go to this is my friend's life. Life is nothing but struggle for survival. And then do's and don'ts given in Ayurveda, make sure that you adapt yourself to the stresses and strains. What is Parishram? It is a stress to the body. What is Mitahar? Calorie restriction. It is again a challenge to your body. Okay. Just think of not having a lunch or dinner today, and you will feel threatened. Think of going for a long walk or jog, you will feel threatened. When I say you will feel threatened, I mean the organism will feel threatened. And in response to this threat, the organism adapts to the changes and becomes strong. This is what the philosophy of Ayurveda, this is what the philosophy even modern sciences are accepting. And therefore, I say that all eyes are on Ayurveda today. So, Ayurveda is not at all old science. We change in attitude. This is the most living, vital science. And the world over, we are all looking at Ayurveda as the future medicine, the holistic medicine. Living systems has the ability to counteract and adapt in response to any disturbance, challenge, and stress. By accepting Mitahar, calorie restriction, and Parishram, physical activity, what are we doing? We are making living systems able to counteract and adapt in response to that disturbance, challenge, and stress, and become strong. This is the principle of Ayurvedic field. As a result of homeostasis ability, this challenge of Parishram and Mitahar is counteracted, damage is repaired, and new adapted state for survival is achieved. Complete Ayurveda is based on complete Ayurvedic do's and don'ts, recommendations for keeping oneself healthy, are challenges to the living organism. And in response to that challenge, the living organism counteracts those challenges, damage is repaired, and a new adapted state for survival is achieved. Just think of that healthy upvas and you feel healthier the other day. Just go for a walk, 30, 40 minutes, brisk walk. And after you have your walk completed, you feel healthy. Why? Because you get adapted to a new state for survival. And because of that adaptation, you feel healthy. You remain healthy forever. And therefore, scope for this Ayurveda is for prevention of disease conditions, for therapy of the diseases, and even for preventing the complications. And we do recommend diet and exercise, herbal medicines. We do also recommend certain minerals and heavy metals for keeping the organism in a healthy state. I will end my Ayurvedic Mahatmya by making you understand that the Nobel Prizes in medicine, right from 2015, 2016, 2017, 18, 19, 22, 20, do authenticate Ayurvedic principles. The roots of this 2015 Nobel Prize, 2016 Nobel Prize, 17, 18, 19 are already described in Ayurveda. So 2016 for autophagy. Autophagy is nothing but the mode of mechanism of upvas. Autophagy is nothing but the mode of mechanism of parishram and mitahar. Then we have 2017, circadian, brahme murte uttishte, the mode of mechanism of brahme murte uttishte got the Nobel Prize in 2017. And similarly, the dosha samya homeostasis 2018, then 2019, just go through Google and then you will understand. When I recommend a Kumbhak Pranayam for a person, for a patient to stay healthy, how does that Kumbhak Pranayam, how does that retention pranayam help you in staying healthy? That mode of mechanism is identified in 2019. So 2021, October 4th, they will declare the Nobel Prize in medicine. And I'm pretty sure that even 2021 Nobel Prize will really give a proof to the truthfulness of our ancient Ayurvedic science. And therefore, we should be confident enough to follow the Ayurvedic do's and don'ts, theories and therapies to treat dementia. We have already talked about dementia as an acquired syndrome consisting of decline in memory and other cognitive functions. In the introduction itself, we did mention this. The main entry is dementia. Etymology, Latin, from dement means mind, a condition of deteriorated mentality, often with emotional apathy. The persons do not have emotions at all. Madness, insanity are the severe manifestations of dementia. So dementia does affect people at different stages of life. It affects different parts of the brain at different speeds. The symptoms that occur when the brain is affected by aging: failure of brain's functions like cognition, comprehension, expression, etc., etc. And it is a chronic progressive problem of knowing, understanding, grasping, making meaning of the surrounding. So dementia is very common, my friends. And there is a memory impairment. There are defects like aphasia, apraxia, agnosia. There is impaired executive functioning. And these deficits do cause significant impairment in social and occupational functioning. I will go a little fast because I think time is not on my side. Just have a look at this. This is Alzheimer's disease assessment score, cognition subset. At the age of 40, gradually, there is subjective cognitive impairment, then mild cognitive impairment, and post 65, there is huge, fast downfall in the mental capacities. So most people notice memory impairment when they become 40 years old on average. This is called a subjective cognitive impairment, SCI, in which the whole capacity, including the social life, personal life, and biological life are preserved. Then there is mild cognitive impairment and there is severe cognitive impairment, post 65. We did talk about this kind of subjective cognitive impairment and dementia at the beginning of our lecture. So early stage of dementia, it can appear slight, the person can appear slightly confused, may need some extra support, minor changes in behavior, and these are noticed by the relations, can be mistaken as a process of aging, illness, such as infection. Then there are middle stage, which talks about changes become more marked, can become more forgetful, will need more support with daily living tasks. At this stage, people can become easily upset, angry, aggressive, depressed. And you have a late stage of dementia, the person will be unable to do any simple task. The person may lose the ability to communicate and mobility will be affected, or it could become confined to bed or wheelchair. So we need to prevent this kind of advancement from early, middle, and late. And that is where we'll talk about the medicines. So the government, these are the living well with dementia, has become the objective of today's mankind. Just read this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th bullet point. Non-pharmacological interventions are also treatments. So when I talk about Ayurvedic way of treating the dementia patients, even if I do recommend certain single ingredients, I'm talking about non-pharmacological interventions are treatments, okay? And dementia is the fourth disease conditions where non-pharmacological interventions are preferred most, because pharmacological interventions in the treatment of dementia are not without any side effects. They do have side effects, and therefore we are looking forward to dementia treatment and prevention by using certain herbal medicine and certain do's and don'ts as described in Ayurveda. So early onset, when do you see the specialist? Early onset, less than 60. When do you see a specialist? When the presentation is atypical. When do you see a specialist? In case of severe Parkinson, focal finding, abnormal scan. When the behaviors are untreatable, it is better to see a specialist. Till then, we can make sure that we take anti-aging medicines of Ayurveda. Till that time, we can take Rasayan medicines. Rasayan medicines are Ayurvedic specialty. One of the branch of Ayurveda is called as Rasayan. And in modern language, they are translated as anti-aging medicine. So taking anti-aging medicines, which are targeted towards the health of brain, will help you prevent and treat dementia in a better way. So all lifestyle disorders, be it obesity, hypertension, diabetes, are responsible for neurodegeneration. Nervous system degenerates. Just read this. Scientists have found that Alzheimer, a neurodegenerative disorder, may actually be a late stage of type 2 diabetes. So much so that in today's medical science, Alzheimer's disease is called as type 3 diabetes mellitus. The findings also suggest that losing weight and exercise may ward off Alzheimer's, at least in the very early stages, researchers say. So healthy lifestyle of Parishram and Mitahar will help in prevention of dementia, will help treating mild to moderate cases of dementia. This is the important thing of that particular shloka, which I cite very often in my lectures. Parishram and Mitahar. Just understand, Alzheimer's disease is called as type 3 diabetes in today's modern science. And the article talks about certain findings of a certain study suggesting that losing weight, why don't you see Mitahar there, and exercising, Parishram, may ward off Alzheimer's at least in the very early stages and researches. That is what the conclusion of the study is. So if we are handling dementia patient, if they are mild cases, moderate cases, we will certainly make their life happier by making them understand and then making them follow a certain kind of diet control and certain kind of physical exercise. And this kind of therapy will certainly help Alzheimer's patients. And with those lifestyle changes, we may recommend certain herbs and spices. They have been used since ancient times to not only improve the flavor of edible food, but also to prevent and treat chronic health maladies. Beneficial actions of herbs and spices include anti-inflammatory medicines, antioxidant properties, antihypertensives, glucoregulatory, and antithrombotic effect. And I will make you understand and I'll make you grasp the meaning of that shloka, Parishram and Mitahar. All that Parishram and Mitahar, physical exercise and calorie restriction, is anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, antihypertensive, glucoregulatory, and antithrombotic. So make sure that your dementia patient gets the behavioral changes and adopts physical exercise and calorie restriction as therapy for dementia. They are neuroprotective in nature. And you see this, curcuma, our household haldi, is the right medicine for Alzheimer's and also for diabetes mellitus. In recent years, haldi, curcuma longa, turmeric has been reported to possess anti-amyloidogenic, anti-inflammatory, antioxidative properties with potential for neuroprotective effects. So regular consumption of curcuma will protect the nervous system, the neurons, and this will help you prevent advancement of dementia. This slide is very crystal clear, my friends. Pathological stress of hypertension and diabetes and cardiac dysfunction will result into Alzheimer's disease. So when we talk about single herbs, they are antihypertensive, anti-diabetic, and neuroprotective at the same time, because the brain-heart axis is associated with Alzheimer's disease. Worldwide, I don't think I will go through this slide, but there are certain 12 points, which is less education, hearing loss, traumatic brain, hypertension, alcohol, smoking, etc., etc. These are the risk factors of modifiable risk factors of diabetes. 40% of dementia cases could be prevented or delayed by targeting these 12 modifiable risk factors. I will repeat that calorie restriction and that physical exercise will help us target these 12 modifiable risk factors, reducing the dementia prevalence. I will talk about certain herbs because that's where the therapy will help us understand. So Brahmi, Bacopa moneri, is good for boosting memory. And it is the best medicine for treatment of dementia. Just appreciate the name of the product, Brahmi. Again, that Brahmi Murti Uttishte. Brahma is Gyan. Nan is cognition. Cognition is brain's function. And therefore, Brahmi is the leader in treatment of dementia. And this study published in 2021 talks about the cognitive training on markers of brain microstructure and the neurocognitive effects of Bacopa moneri, that is Brahmi. Ashwagandha, you must have heard about this plant very often during these corona days. It is again anti-dementia medicine. It is adaptogenic, it relieves anxiety, and it does boost stamina as well. Tulsi, Osimum Sanctum, a very sacred plant, is the best plant for the neuroprotection. And if you appreciate the publication dates of this, 2021, 2018, like that. Shatavari is again a women's health medicine, and it does reduce the stress, especially in female reproductive system. It is anti-stress and it helps in arresting dementia. And I'm very happy to tell you that we at Sandu Pharmaceuticals are going to launch these products very soon. Guduchi again is a Nervine health tonic. It's an immunomodulator, anti-aging, and it does have anti-stress, anti-diabetic, anti-inflammatory activities, which help in neuroprotection, which help in treating and preventive nervous system damage. Haldi, I did talk about Haldi. There are a number of reports on use of Haldi in Alzheimer's disease and dementia, and also as anti-diabetic medicine, anti-cholesterol medicine. And this is the household remedy, okay, comes in a dosage form. I'll end my presentation with some daily techniques. A simple type of daily meditation may alter the course of Alzheimer's. My friends, for mild to moderate patients, one can always recommend a kind of meditation early in the morning. Say, for example, with folded hands, you sit in front of the God, close your eyes, and say the prayer, Vakratunda Mahakaya Suryakoti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kurume Deva Sarvakareshu Sarvada Shubhakareshu Sarvada. Just fold your hands, close your eyes, and say those words, Vakratunda Mahakaya Suryakoti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kurume Deva Shubhakareshu Sarvada. And when you say Vakratunda, think of that trunk of the God Ganesh. When you say Mahakaya, try to visualize the Mahakaya of the God. Suryakoti Samaprabha, please make sure that in front of your eyes, you see that Dipti, you see that Tej, you see that light, which is equivalent to crores of suns. And make this as a practice every day, 5 to 10 minutes. Close your eyes, fold your hands, say that shloka, Vakratunda Mahakaya, and make sure that image appears in your front of eyes. You visualize that image without looking at that photograph. This experiment, this exercise for 5 to 10 minutes will make sure that your both brains, right and left, right brain, that imaging, that visualization, left brain, that Vakratunda word, that Mahakaya word, that Samakoti Samaprabha word, and you connect both and you make sure that you are using both sides of your brain, right and left brain. You are making sure that you utter a word and you see the meaning of the word simultaneously. That is a kind of a brain exercise which will help you control your dementia. And then I have developed a technique based on a poem of Rudyard Kipling. I keep 6 honest serving men. They taught me all I knew. Their names are what and why and when and how, where and who. So to my students, to improve their memory, I give some exercises and I make them understand the importance of why, who, what, where, when and how. I give them a statement, who does what, when, where, why and how. And whatever they read, they have to remember that sentence, that paragraph, using this template, who does what, when, where, why, and how. So there's a news item in the newspaper. I make them read the first statement of the news, and they have to remember it using this template, who does what, when, where, why, and now. So we begin with the simple statements, and then we end with paragraph long statements. Say, for example, a statement or a paragraph from Tale of Two Cities. I will make them understand and read certain paragraphs, certain sentences from Harry Potter books. And this is how you improve your memory. And these are the exercises, very easy to use. And one can really make use of this, who does what, when, where, why, and how, and teach our patients. Doing this very often, now that volunteer understands that method, that technique, he is happy, and there is a reward mechanism in the brain which will release the dopamine. So if I feel strong enough, if I feel confident enough to memorize that one lengthy statement, if I feel confident enough to memorize that paragraph long statement, the reward mechanisms of my brain get activated. And these activated reward mechanisms will make sure that dopamine levels increase. Dopamine is a hormone which has a feel-good factor, which gives you a feel-good factor. It will act on your brain area, which stimulates your memory, and you start treating your dementia right from the practice of this who does what, when, where. Okay, so these are the exercises. The Brahmi, Shatavari, Ashwagandha are the medicines. Rational, judicious use of both practices, of course, with Parishram and Mitahar, are the right remedies, are the right therapy for treating dementia. Thank you, friends, for kind attention. And if you have queries and suggestions, please make sure to contact me on medicalcell1@sandhu.in. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for your patience. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Patil, for your wonderful, wonderful presentation and giving some of very practical home-based things to apply and use. I would like to invite now Dr. Harish Verma to do a Q&A session. Dr. Verma, over to you.
Before Dr. Harish speaks, let me add, okay, we have heard whenever we talk about Ayurveda, we talk about Panchakarma a lot. Okay, so one question may arise, what is the Panchakarma that one should recommend to treat dementia patients? And I think I should answer this. There are bastis described in Charak Samhita, which are called as Yapan bastis. And there are very, very specific bastis described in Charak Samhita, which are focused on the therapy of dementia and mental disorders. Thank you, sir. Hariji, you may go ahead with your question.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Patilji, it was a wonderful presentation, and thank you very much for that. You had made an excellent blend of Ayurveda and modern science. This is what is our aim, and we are trying to present Ayurveda in a modern way to the Western society. And your reference of getting up early in the morning, in getting up early in Brahmahurt, it matches with the very popular proverb, early to bed, early to rise makes the person healthy, wealthy, and wise. So it is definitely, and you mentioned that you gave the reference, and I learned, it's excellent. Now, sir, I got a few questions. My first question is, for children, can you suggest any formulation which people can make at their home, like a mixture of Brahmi or Badam or Mishri or anything like that, which they can give to the children, those particularly who cannot perform well in exams. Any okay. preparation which can be made in the kitchen, please suggest.
Yeah, I would recommend a combination of two herbs. One is haldi and the second is yashti madhu glycyrrhiza glabra.
Okay.
So, So the combination of haldi and yashti madhu, they are brain tonics. And we are all aware that young age is the predominance of kapha dosha. So haldi and yashti madhu are good for kapha dosha as well. And they are good nootropic medicines. And there is a lot of evidence for as Narvain tonic or nootropic for yashti madhu and haldi. So a combination of haldi, maybe if you're talking about a school going child, 500 milligram of haldi and 500 milligram of yashti madhu with honey can play a very important role in keeping their respiratory system healthy and nervous system.
Thank you, sir. And what is your experience about Medhya Rasayan, the four herbs, combination of four herbs mentioned in Charak Samhita, like Brahmi, Madhukarni, Gaduchi, and
Yashti Madhu. Yes. There are a number of.
What is your experience?
I don't have a direct experience of this, but number of MD students do really study this Medhya Rasayan concept in their clinical setup. And especially in elderly patients, nootropic effect in the patients. So when you talk about the Medhya Rasayan, as mentioned in Charak Samhita, Guduchi, Mandukarni, Yashti Madhu, and that fourth one, they are very good for Guduchi, for improving the nervous system.
What is the commonest medicine, commonest herb which is available in India or abroad, which you recommend for general people for prevention of dementia in old age?
I think Brahmi can be taken as a daily medication to keep your brain healthy.
So, sir, can it be taken for a longer period, for 2-3 years, 5 years?
Yes, lifelong it can be taken. Because this Rasayan medicine.
What is the role of almond in improving the cognitive function?
Almond is again called as a Narvain tonic, and it does provide certain fatty acids which are good for nervous tissue.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Over to Sthishji.
And I always feel that Ayurveda describes a combination of Ahar, Vihar, and Aushad. Okay, so as far as Vihar goes, I have talked about certain exercises, and as far as Aushad goes, we did talk about certain single herbs like Brahmi, Mandukarni, etc. So the combination of Ahar, Vihar, Aushad work in a synergistic way. They potentiate each other's action. So somebody should not feel that I'm taking Brahmi, so I need not do this. Memory techniques or who does what, six honest servants, etc. That's not the case. And Parishram Itahar will always stay the mainstay or main pillars of health. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sriji, you're on mute.
Sorry about that. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Verma. And before I invite Ritesh for the final concluding remark, Dr. Patil, what is your recommendation? Like some of the herbs which you mentioned, whether it's a haldi, guduchi, brahmi, can that be regularly taken for anyone not even having any kind of symptom as more of a preventative measure as a lifelong or any?
They can be taken as a preventive measure. Why talk about prevention? We can talk about promotion of nervous system for life.
And any particular quantity you recommend?
I think generally when we recommend the quantities of herbs, it is in if you talk about the quantities of churnas, 1-3 grams, but then 500 to 1,000 milligram daily is good enough. Because we are talking about the prevention and we are not talking about the therapeutic doses here.
Ji ji, Thank you. Thank you so very much. Ritesh, over to you.
Thank you, Satish ji. Thank you very much, Vaidya Milind Patil ji, for your very informative presentation on Ayurvedic management of dementia. As we know that this is one of the most common health issues with the world, and it requires time, focus, and efforts at multiple levels to prevent and manage such health condition. Dementia seems to be a palliative condition as per Ayurvedic understanding of its pathogenesis. Early detection of the problem and early treatment is required to prevent the progress of the disease. Ayurvedic approach to management with Medha Rasayana and Panchkarma therapy is very useful in the treatment of dementia and effective in improving the quality of life of the patient. Thanks for letting our audience know that Ayurvedic medications and therapeutic techniques for the management of neurodegenerative diseases, especially dementia, are very effective if used judiciously, which are still a very gray area in the conventional medicine. We would also like to thank our special guest, MPP Deepak Anandji, for joining us on Sunday morning in spite of his travels and being on road today. A special thanks to all the virtual audiences for their consistent support to this CIF initiative. We welcome your ideas, feedback, and recommendations to make the series more valuable for you. Also, I would like to thank our partners, Canadian Ayurvedic Practitioners Association, headed by our very own Dr. Harish Verma ji, Vedic Spiritual Heritage Foundation, and Consulate General of India to support this initiative. Thanks to Y Media for covering this program live. Friends, also please stay in tune for our next webinar on Ayurvedic management of polycystic ovarian syndrome, Sunday, 8th August, 2021. Our expert speaker for this session would be Dr. Neeta Maheshkar from India. Please stay connected, stay safe, stay healthy, and get vaccinated as soon as possible. Thank you and namaste.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to all. Namaste to all.